Thank you, Simon and Crystal, for reading our scripture passage this morning. In 1976, a British band called 10cc, oh, I see Brian Gibson's here. He probably already knows the song that I'm about to talk about. Don't say it. 10cc released a song that became a hit in various countries around the world. It played repeatedly on the radio for years. On the pop charts, it made it up to number 6 in the UK, number 5 in the US and Australia, number 2 in Ireland, and number 1 in Canada. Here is a 30-second clip from this song. See if you've heard it before. Communication is the problem to the answer. Did you ever see it? It's like a one-hit wonder. You guys are ready to song? What's the name of it?
Like walking in the rain and the storms when there's no way to go.
Does this bring back some memories? A little bit? Things you do for love, walking in the rain and the snow, doing whatever it takes to spend time with that special someone, with that guy or that gal that you love or that you're trying to win over, trying to woo, trying to draw them into that relationship and captivate them and sweep them off their feet. The things we do for love. When Sandra and I met, this was a little bit of our story. When we met in Bible college at Multnomah University, we were just friends for many months. And during that time, we would go jogging together. She had been in cross country in high school and was an athlete. And I had not been in cross country and I was not an athlete, but she liked to run and so I liked to run. She wanted to go jogging and so I loved jogging. I mean, if she had told me that she only dated cowboys, I would have put on boots and a hat and said, I'm picking you up at 6 on my horse, right? Because, well, the things that you do to spend time with that person that you want to win over, right? That girl or guy that you like. So we would run every couple of days, and then every day, and then for an hour every day, and we didn't care about how fast we were going or how far we went, because when you jog kind of slow, you can talk and get to know each other. And little tip here for you young men who are here, jogging together is nice, because then if you don't have anything to say, you don't have to say anything. You just jog along, it's kind of nice, it's not awkward. At least it wasn't for us. We were very comfortable, we got to know each other through lots of runs. And then there was this bench just outside the girls' dorm. And so when we would finish our run for the day, we would go over to the girls' dorm and I would be dropping her off and we would see this bench and we would sit down and we would just chat. And sometimes we would talk for maybe 20 or 30 minutes and then maybe an hour and then sometimes maybe 2 hours. And even if we had studies to do, we would still want to talk. And after a while, I'm thinking, man, I got to use more deodorant because I am stinking. You know what I'm saying? So after many months of jogging together, we eventually got married. And we're going to come back to that story later, but for now, I want to talk about a very different love story. It's a very different love story, but there are some things that we're going to learn about this love story that I believe have the potential to change every relationship that you have. In fact, before the end of our time this morning, I would like to share some concepts with you drawn from some love stories in Scripture that once I began to really apply them, they completely changed all of my relationships. The principles that we're going to look at today, after many years of learning them and trying to live them out, have literally revolutionized every single one of my relationships with other people. My relationship with my wife, with my kids, with my extended family, with my coworkers, with my boss, with my neighbors, with the people in our homeowners association. And let me tell you, that's a miracle, right? Every single one of these relationships have been impacted, and I would say even transformed by the concepts that we're going to be talking about today. The love story that I want to focus on today is actually between Paul and a group of people in the city of Lystra. Now, as Simon and Crystal read for us earlier, Paul and Barnabas went and preached the gospel in Lystra. As we discovered, the people tried to sacrifice a bull to them, but Barnabas and Paul explained that there are humans just like them, and they used the occasion to preach the gospel, the good news about the one true God who created the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that's in them. And how that one true God is calling us to turn away from our idols, all the things that we're trusting in to bring us life, to turn away from those false gods that don't really give life at all, and turn towards the one true God who created us and who provides for us food and even gives us things like joy. It's interesting that he uses the idea that God gives them joy as part of his presentation of the gospel, and that he is the one we are to trust in to give us life. So then some Jews show up and they stir up the crowd and they start throwing rocks at Paul, and that mob mentality starts to kick in, and the leaders are shouting, "Stone the blasphemer!" And everyone joins in and they start stoning Paul, and he falls down, and they probably hit him with sticks for a while, and then he stops moving. And maybe they see some blood coming out of his ear or out of his mouth. And they hit him a few more times, but he's still not moving at all. And so they conclude, well, he must be dead. And they don't want a dead body near their homes within the city walls. It can spread disease and flies and smells nasty. And so they drag his dead body outside of the city, and they leave him out there in the dust, outside the walls, dead. That's Paul. So there's Paul's body lying in the dirt. Finally, some of the disciples gather around him. And here we have one of the most incredible verses in the whole entire story. In fact, I would consider this one of the most astonishing and bewildering statements in all the missionary journeys of Paul. It says very simply, Paul got up and went back into the city. Amen. Now here is where Vicini the Sicilian would say, it's inconceivable. Why would he do such a thing? What possessed him? What is going on? How could he go back into Lystra after what just happened? They didn't just give him a bad review with one star on the Google app. They didn't just use foul language. They didn't just push him around. They threw rocks. They left him for dead. But Paul got up and went back into the very city where he was just almost killed. And that should cause us to pause and ask the question, how? How was he able to get up and walk right back into that very place? When I was doing some research on this passage, I ran across one commentator who writes, listen carefully, this is very interesting to me. Paul and his companions were continually persecuted by the Jewish leaders from Asia and Greece. Yet the Lord protected them in every circumstance, and Paul was determined to run the race that was set before him. Now, you notice anything odd about that commentary? The Lord protected them? That's a strange comment, because it sure doesn't seem like Paul was protected. He was preserved from death, sure, but I wouldn't say he was protected. In fact, quite the opposite. God allowed him to take all kinds of hits. God allowed him to be beaten and persecuted over and over again. And that's something to remember as we consider our own expectations of life and relationships and what it means to be in a relationship with God, right? Do we expect that God will protect us from pain and troubles? If we think we follow the kind of God that keeps us away from harm, then we're believing a lie, because I cannot find that kind of God in my experience, or in the life of Paul, or in the teachings of Jesus, or anywhere in the Bible. So if God is not going to protect Paul from being beaten, then how is it that he is able to get up and immediately go right back into Lystra? This is the operative question that emerges from our text today. How is it that Paul was able to continue to love and forgive and serve the very people who beat him? What enabled him to love his enemies and preach the gospel of grace to those who persecuted him? And isn't that the core question of the whole Christian life? Isn't that a key question when we read the teachings of Jesus? When someone hits me on one cheek, Jesus asks me to turn the other cheek. And I think he really means it. Do we really believe that Jesus really meant what he said? When someone in authority tells us to carry a load for 1 mile for them, Jesus wants us to willingly comply and then carry it a second mile. When someone who hates you sues you for the shirt off your back, Jesus asks us to give them your shirt. And then turn around and give them your coat as well. Jesus calls us as his followers to love our enemies in these very tangible ways. But the question that haunts those of us who follow Jesus is how? How is it that I can find a way to do these things? Jesus says that if I want to follow him, I must give up my life, take up that cross, and live the way he lived. But how can I do that? In 2017, I was preparing for my daughter's wedding. And I was thinking about what scripture passages I might share and what things I might talk about. And so I was reading through the vows that my wife wrote and that my daughter had chosen, and I read these words. I am not coming into this union empty and looking for love. I am coming already full from God's love with plenty to share. I will continue to love and serve you through any financial, physical, or relational hardships that we may face. And that was their promise. And that, I thought to myself, are some very powerful words. And I thought about John chapter 15, where Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And I pictured this branch connected to this vine. And so the branch stays connected to the vine and the nourishing sap goes up the vine and the branch. And then it bears the fruit. And the people can come up and eat from the fruit. And we had the opportunity recently to go to Italy, and then we noticed vineyards everywhere, these vineyards, these grapes everywhere. And we were walking from the bus stop one time to our hospitality house, and we noticed there's no fence here. Like, somebody could just walk up to that vineyard and pick those grapes. And like, the vine wouldn't care. The vine wouldn't know, because the vine would continue to bear fruit regardless of who picked the grapes, regardless of what response the grapes got, because its nourishment comes from the sap that comes from the branch that comes from the soil. And so this picture entered my mind of this vine and its branches, and then I thought about that phrase, apart from me, you can do nothing. And it reminded me of in John 5 where Jesus says, the Son can do nothing on his own. He can only do what the Father does. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. And just as the Father raises the dead and gives life, so the Son gives life to those he is pleased to give it. And then later in the same passage, Jesus says, by myself, I can do nothing. So Jesus himself says, by myself, I can do nothing. And so I started thinking about this picture. Jesus is always looking to the Father. And the Father says to Jesus, you are my beloved. You are my Son. In you I am pleased. And you can find all kinds of passages about how Jesus continually looked to the Father for everything, all the time. He depended on his Father for everything. And then I pictured Jesus while they're nailing him to the cross. And in that moment, he is not receiving any love from the people who are nailing him to the cross. He is not receiving admiration. He's getting no affirmation, no positive feedback. In fact, he's getting the exact opposite. They're spitting on him, beating him, pulling out his beard, nailing his arms to the wood. And he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. How is it that at the very moment that Jesus was rejected by his people, betrayed by his followers, abandoned by his disciples, and crucified by his enemies, how is it in the very moment that he's giving his life for these people who are killing him, he's praying for their forgiveness? And then it hit me. It's because he never depended upon them in the first place. There's an interesting passage in John chapter 2. I'll let you look it up later. In John chapter 2, it says that many believed in the name of Jesus, but he did not entrust himself to them. So many people believed in the name of Jesus, but he didn't entrust himself to them. And it's the same word in the Greek, the believe and entrust. It's the same exact word in the Greek. So it's something like this. They trusted in him, but he did not trust in them because he knew what they were all about. So who is he trusting in? Where was he getting his life source, his encouragement, his motivation to continue to love in the face of everything that happened to him? It's always from his Father. And so this aha moment came as I was trying to describe how Jesus drew all of his strength to turn the other cheek when he was beaten, to go the extra mile when he was walking to the cross, and to offer his own life as a sacrifice for the very people who were killing him. The only way he could go through with it is because he made it a constant practice to draw his strength from his Father alone by trusting continually in his Father's love and strength and life and value and identity. And now, once I saw that, once I saw this concept, that it's not this back and forth, it's not that, you know, I got a stack of marriage books here, and it's like, you know, waffles and spaghetti. Men are waffles, women are spaghetti, and men are from Mars and women are from Venus, and his needs, her needs, and love and respect, and there's good stuff in these books, okay, so I'm not trying to bash them, but you know, after a while, there's this sort of subtle implication that I meet your needs, you meet my needs. We have this contract. You're gonna do this for me, I'm gonna do this for you. And particularly his needs, her needs. It's pretty blatant in that book that there's like this social contract, this marriage contract we're making to meet one another's needs. And the more I search the scripture with this concept in mind, the more I realize that I bought into a lie. That this isn't really how relationships are supposed to work at all. Actually, quite the opposite. I am supposed to enter into that relationship already full and ready to give. But the only way I can do that is if I'm full from my Father. It has been said that anytime you see a living organism thrive, it will always be drawing nourishment from an outside source. And Christ's relationship with us is the same. Jesus doesn't look to us to get his motivation to love us. He draws it from the Father. Marriage partners cannot look to their spouse to get the power needed to make the relationship work. They must always tap into an outside source. We need a source of love outside of ourselves to be secure and strong enough to love someone in the sacrificial way that is required for marriage to work. And this applies to all relationships. And then I began to evaluate much of what I had learned about marriage and how I approached my relationship with Sandra. And as much as I would say that my needs for love was fully met in God, there were many times that I would come home from work and I would walk into the house and I would greet her and she would be doing something and I would just hoping that she would stop what she's doing and turn and love me and hug me and greet me. And when she wouldn't, it kind of hurt. I would feel deflated. I might even be a bit angry because she knows what my love language is. We read all the books. She knows that that's what fills me up, is that physical affection, that hug. And as I was trying to do my part, many times I felt like she wasn't doing her part, and it hurt. Or I would spend a day working in the yard, cutting the grass. It'd be really nice, like with the diagonal lines, right? You could tell the grass was just cut. And the patio, I'd sweep the patio, pick up the house. And it was like she didn't even notice. And I'd be like, honey, did you see the yard? See the patio? Don't they look nice? And she'd say, oh, yeah, they look great. They look great. Thanks, John. Or I would cook a special dinner, and I'm waiting. And I'm waiting, and we're eating. And I'm waiting, and I'm waiting. And finally, it's like, how do you like the chicken? Oh, it's really good. It's really good. And you see, I'm thinking, she knows that my other love language is verbal affirmation, right? So physical affection, I like hugs, and verbal affirmation, I want to hear that you're appreciating what I'm doing for you. And so why is it that I always have to remind her to give me that compliment, to love me the way the love languages say that she's supposed to? And it sounds like a small thing. It sounds even like petty. But combined with the other challenges and hurts in my life, not feeling love from Sandra is really difficult. Because I was feeling empty and unloved by her. And if my own wife couldn't make me feel loved, then maybe I was unlovable. And that cuts to the core of my own self-worth, because if I'm not worthy of love, then maybe I'm not valuable as a human being, and that's the worst feeling that someone could ever have. To be so unlovable that I don't even have value as a human being. And so to avoid that feeling of not being valuable, I would try to figure out ways to show her how hurt I was or how angry I was, that she didn't seem to care, that I was really needing her to meet this need of affirmation that I seemed to have. And so then I had this aha moment where I realized I've been preaching and teaching to others about getting their needs fully met in Christ for years, but I'd not really internalized this concept myself. I knew it in my head. I could explain it. I could teach it. But for some reason, I wasn't experiencing it deep down in my soul. And then over time, I realized that our beliefs are kind of like an iceberg. There are our stated beliefs that are up there in that top 10% that we see. I'll call these my conscious or stated beliefs that we can articulate and explain. God meets all my needs for security and significance. But then there's the other 90% of our beliefs that reside under the surface. Let's call them my unconscious or my internalized beliefs. And these can sometimes, in fact, these can often be in tension with the stated beliefs that we know consciously. So my stated belief is that God meets all of my needs for love and acceptance, and that I am the beloved of God. But deep down inside, I have this other belief that if my wife doesn't show me love, then maybe I'm not lovable. If those I work with don't show me respect, then maybe I'm not worthy of respect. If people reject me or don't like me, then maybe I'm not as likable or important as I thought. If the people I care about turn their back on me, then maybe I'm not as valuable as I once believed. And so there's the stated belief that I have, and I really do believe it. I honestly believe that I'm loved by God and that He can and does meet all of my needs for love. But under the surface, I'm depending on others to meet those needs, but I didn't even know it. I didn't even realize that dependence was there until those things were taken away. It wasn't until the scaffolding of the approval of others was taken away that I realized that my foundation of security in Christ was not as secure as I thought. And without that scaffolding, my building of self-worth came tumbling down. But it was all grace. It was all grace because at that point, God said to me, John, these are the ways that you're not trusting in me. These are the areas in your life where I want you to turn to me instead of these other people and things. These are your Zeus and your Hermes that you've been sacrificing to because you saw me heal one lame man and you thought that I would always heal. But you're not the one that's going to be healed in the story. In fact, you might be the one pelted with stones and rocks and left for dead. So you must draw your identity from me, John, so that you can get back up and forgive and serve and give the coat as well as the shirt. And he was so gentle with me. He was so kind to me. He said, John, I so much want you to learn to trust and depend on me alone that I'm going to allow you to go through a season where it's going to feel like everything else you are trusting in is threatened or being taken from you. And everything besides me that you are holding on to is going to be slowly peeled away. And I'm going to allow you to feel what it's like to trust in me alone. And it was around that time, several years ago, that I began using this stack of cards. These are verse cards. They're not really memory verse cards because there are several in here that I haven't even tried to memorize. They're cards that have specific scriptures on one side, and then on the other side, specific truths from those scriptures that I want to remind myself of day after day and to go back to again and again. And so I started carrying around this packet of cards, and I started writing scriptures on them and truths on them so that I can take what I say I believe, my stated beliefs, and internalize them so that they'll make their way down into my internalized beliefs. On many cards, there's a verse on one side. On the other side is maybe a prayer or some bullet points of truths that I want to remember. And at this time, I would like to ask my wife, Sandra, to come up. I've shared a little bit this morning about our marriage, and I've asked her to come and share with you maybe a little of the other side of the story.
So I first learned the concept of getting my needs for security and significance in God from a book, The Marriage Builder by Dr. Larry Crabb. And it just talks about getting our needs for security and significance from God rather than depending on our spouse to be, fulfill our needs. And I really thought I understood those concepts, and I tried really hard to apply them, but it was a lot harder than I thought. I was all ready to be unselfish and minister to my husband's needs, but I didn't know that it was impossible to do without having a dependent relationship with God. I often found myself feeling hurt and angry at John when he would give me advice on how to do the laundry and tell me that I used the wrong color of paint on the walls, or disagree with me about when the best time to open and close windows on a hot day was. And I would often tell him that I felt like he was treating me like I was stupid. And he would insist that he did not think of me that way and that he was only trying to help. I felt insecure, and I really wished John would affirm me. I also found it very difficult to give him any praise or affirmation for what he did if he didn't give me affirmation for what I did first. Because I believed that he thought he was smarter and better than me, and I thought he was comparing us in his own mind. Whenever John didn't seem to take my opinions and input seriously, it felt like a value judgment on my intelligence. And my intelligence was monumentally important to me, because when I felt intelligent, I felt worthy as a person. But when I felt stupid, I had no basis for worth as a human being. And that is the worst possible pain that exists. After many years of soul searching, reading more books, and counseling, I realized that on a deep, unconscious level, I held a belief that I had no talent, beauty, gifts, or abilities, but at least I had intelligence. I believed deep down that my intelligence was the one thing, the only thing, that gave me value. I thought I was worthless without it. So whenever John would make a comment that struck that intelligence nerve, it would threaten my whole sense of self-worth. I was dependent on John to believe that I was intelligent, to feel like I had worth. When I realized I had been giving John the power to give and take away my value, I was shocked. I knew that I had to find new ways of thinking. I had to admit that John wasn't really guilty of making me feel stupid. I had to take responsibility for being so insecure that I was completely dependent on him to make me feel like I had worth. I faced my need to find the true source of my value, a source that was so stable that I would always be okay regardless of what others thought of me. I came to realize that I was evaluating my worth based on the wrong things. I'm not valuable because of my positive traits, like intelligence or talents or gifts. I'm valuable because of the personhood inside of me that was made in the image of God, because God chose me and adopted me, because Jesus sacrificed his life for me, and because God says, I am the beloved. God gave me my value as a gift, and I can't earn it, and it can't be taken away. I've learned that turning to anything other than God for my value brings death to my life and relationships. I've had to repent of turning to my intelligence for my worth, and I've had to transfer my dependency to God instead, because he is the only true source of value. I learned that knowing God could meet my needs for security and significance, and actively turning to him and depending on him to meet my needs were completely different things. I'm still learning how to depend on God by spending time with him every day, asking him to meet my needs for love, value, and security, memorizing specific scriptures related to my deficiencies, and then taking the time to receive his living water. When I'm secure in the identity that I have in Christ and the unshakable love that he has for me, I don't have to try hard to love and serve John. God's love transforms me into a person who is so full that servanthood, grace, and forgiveness happen naturally because I'm a different person. I'm no longer easily wounded. I no longer feel hurt when he gives me unsolicited help with things. I no longer accuse him of treating me like I'm stupid. And I have realized that it was me who thought we needed to compare. And now that I know that there's no need for comparison because we are already equally valuable in Christ, it's easy for me to give praise and encouragement because lifting John up is no longer threatening my value. The secret to serving others sacrificially and expecting nothing in return is having a life-giving, dependent relationship with God and allowing him to supply all of our needs for love, value, acceptance, and security. No person is capable of meeting our needs. They weren't designed to do that for us. As I become more secure in Christ, I can enter into all of my relationships already full rather than entering into relationships needy and insecure. My newfound security has allowed me to love and serve John in a way that I couldn't before. I wasn't able to minister to John because I was too busy trying to protect my crippled self-worth. I was empty and had nothing to give. But when all of my needs for love, acceptance, and value are met by God in a concrete way on a daily basis, I don't need to worry about myself. I'm full, and I can give out of the overflow.
How do you get up off the ground, dust yourself off, and go right back into the place where they just tried to kill you? You've got to be full in Christ. And you have to internalize those truths that you say you believe up here. And you really do. But they've got to sink in. And so we're going to take the next few minutes, and we'll have just maybe a minute of silence. And in your bulletin are there's a bulletin insert. Please, everybody, open your bulletin. I should have used it there. Everybody, open your bulletin. There's a list of verses that I would like to suggest maybe you start with, or if you have a verse that you know, take this card and write that verse on one side of the card, and then flip it over, and on the other side, write the truth that you want to internalize deep down into that 90%, those unconscious beliefs, so that then you can be reminded of your identity in Christ, your fullness in him. And so we're just going to take the next minute or two, have a time of silence, and then the worship team is going to make their way up here. And when they start playing, if you're still writing, take your time. If you're writing through the whole closing song, take your time to do that. That's fine. But let's just, I want to invite you to write a verse out on your card. Get you started on your stack.